I was a recovering Catholic. I had gone to Catholic school my whole life. I just didn't vibe with that. So I was pretty much on the agnostic spectrum. I believed that there was likely something out there, but I didn't name it, and I didn't really have any practices specific to it. When I was in graduate school for my first master's, I started having a lot of physical symptoms. The condition that they thought I had was something called Wegener's granulomatosis. However, they had misdiagnosed me, and I actually had a combination of lupus with rheumatoid arthritis. The drugs they used for the Wegener's shut down my liver so rapidly that the liver took the lungs and the kidneys, and I was comatose within about an hour of taking the medicine. Thankfully, I was at my parents' house. I had gone to visit them to be assessed at Johns Hopkins, as I'm from the DC area. And they came in from a cruise and found me on the bed, just swollen, completely jaundiced. You bruise really bad when your liver fails. And again, I was swollen so much I was irrecognizable. I was kind of coming in and out. I don't think I was fully comatose until I reached the hospital. I have no recollection of the helicopter ride or anything like that, but I do remember coming out of the body when I was in ICU. As I came out of the body, it's amazing, as you know, that we retain our consciousness. So even though I didn't have the physical body, I was very, like, it was almost funny because I was looking down in ICU and they're wearing yellow scrubs with purple gloves. And being from Los Angeles, I'm like, why is everyone in Lakers clothing? And then I'm looking and I'm like, wait a minute, am I dreaming about the X-Files? Because it like looked like this X-Files scene. And they were working with me just with all this crazy protective gear. I just didn't know what to make sense of it. But then as I went up and up, it became less about what I was seeing and just that gravitational pull to the other side. I was making little jokes to myself and I was realizing I was myself, but I was completely happy. And I felt like this major weight had been lifted from me. This might have been ill for about 10 years at that point. As many experiencers talk about, I do believe it presents in a language you can understand. And having been heavily science-based before I went in, it was for me the most vibrant expression of the cosmos. It's like take NASA's photos and intensify the light to a point you cannot describe. The first experience upon getting into that space was meeting what I deem my guardian angels, and they were orbs, you know, very specific colors. They were gemstone colors, a ruby, amethyst, and an emerald. I was just blown away by it's almost like the song you experience, you know, in their presence. I don't know if soul song would be right or your essence, but you just feel like you're home and you know it. It doesn't need to be said. You just know where you are and you know that this is a place you've been many times, but you're happy to be back. You know, when I saw the source light, which was so different from the angelic light, you know, I had this like, want to go right to it, you know, kind of thing. And they kind of held me back and had a conversation that I was given a choice. I know it's different from everybody, but it was, you know, you're here and you can stay here and you can go to that place or you can go back. They kept talking about the work, my soul contract. That was like the focus of what the discussion was about, and that if I chose to stay, you know, I would ultimately return to fulfill that contract. And so it was made known to me that if I came back now, it would be extraordinarily difficult, except I could do it. And I had the strength to do it. And they were, of course, the way they communicated is so much more loving. And, you know, it's like I was being held. And for me, that was so important, given my background and the parents I chose in this incarnation, because I don't think I ever felt held until that moment. Hence part of why I really wanted to stay. They made it known to me that I was to write, but they didn't let me know about what, you know? And having been an academic prior to this happening, I was in my PhD candidacy at that time. I'm thinking, oh, they want me to go back and finish my dissertation and write. I was totally off. I spent quite a bit of time, do I want to stay? Do I want to go? And they just held me, you know? And then I started looking back, like towards my body, which I didn't see. It was still in that cosmos space. There were these two lights that were very, very different than the angelic light and the source light. And they were like magnets to me. I was like, I want to go back there. But it was made known that if I go back there, that's the way back to the body. That's, you know, a connection to it. And so I guess I said yes in like a split second. Now you have to imagine, I was comatose 3 days. So that time where they were just holding me, when I woke up, that felt like 3 years. So even though I was catapulted back into my body, and as I was going back, I kind of paused at those lights that were different. One was this beautiful indigo blue, and the other one was this green, kind of like the healthiest grass you've ever seen. But they were not angelic, so I was just curious about it. But I didn't have time to dialogue. They did not say anything. So as I'm being pulled back into the body, I ask the angels, how do I get back? And they're like, follow the one light that's unlike all others. And that's when I saw this piercing light. And I opened my eyes and my back in my body, and there's a flashlight, the artificial light of the flashlight. Now I'd been declared brain dead. So my family, I'd been read my last rites. My family expected me not to wake up. If I did wake up, they were told I'd be a vegetable and I wouldn't have, you know, cognitive functioning. So even though they were testing my vitals, no one thought I was in there. So it took quite a long time. I was strapped down because I had a PICC line going into my brain, and I didn't have the strength to move anything and communicate, you know, I'm here. So I induced a bit of a panic attack, which made them, you know, see my vitals. And then after hours, they were like, she's awake. No one came and told me what happened to me. So I'm sitting in ICU, intubated, and I remained intubated for 3 days because my lungs weren't yet strong enough for me to breathe. So when I got a pen and paper, my first communication was not so nice, but it was, you know, why aren't you telling me what's going on? The ego and that former clinician came in for a minute and kind of tried to tell me it was a lucid dream, it was this, it was that. But the part of me, the third eye that had been awoken, was kind of like, no, just ask and they'll come. And so as I was panicking in ICU alone, still waiting to hear what happened to me, my third eye was very much awake. I was seeing auras at that point. I was seeing angels in other people's rooms because, you know, ICU has the glass walls. When they would call code blue or code red and someone would pass, I would see the soul body lift out. So I'm freaking out a bit, and I'm like, they must have gave me good drugs. I don't know what's going on. But then I'm like, you know what? Call in those beings. If it was real, they're going to show up. And so I did, I called on them, I asked for their help, and my room just lit up. I mean, they were no longer, you know, small. It was like they took up the whole hospital. And they really stayed with me and gave me the medicine I needed to sit through that time of unknowing and to really come to peace that this has happened, that things I didn't necessarily believe in before were real, and challenged everything and I thought I was. The organs were so badly damaged, I actually could not be given medication. So when I thought that it was all being caused by, you know, drugs, then they told me, you can't take any medicine. Your liver, like, you were at the point we were gonna get you a transplant, you know, it was your only hope. So I then really did start meditating profusely. I was determined. I was like, I am not going to be in here a month. I'm going to get out of here before, or 6 months. I'm going to get out of here before New Year's. And everybody laughed at me. I'm like, I will. They were like, you're not going to be able to meet with the occupational therapist for at least 3 to 4 weeks. So you're not even going to move your body. I had friends come in. And at night, I was like, you're going to help me. My friend's an occupational therapist. I was like, can you please help me, or I'm going to do it myself. And she knows me well and knows I would have. So she would come in nightly and just kind of work with me. I think I was in ICU about 2.5 weeks before they moved me to a lower level of care. And I continued to just keep going like that. I had friends bring me in food that I actually thought would nourish my body. Once my liver was healthy enough that I could take drugs, I said no to them because that had been what caused all this. And just really worked with the angels to heal the organs. When I was discharged, the doctors actually came in and they all lined up and shook my hand and were like, this is a miracle. We did not expect you to make it. So it was pretty wild. I did actually get to go home. I think it was New Year's Eve.
Be sure to watch the full unedited interview. I have it linked right here, also in the description, or you can search Trisha Barker, Brooke Grove, NDE. If you'd like to see some more of my videos, click right here. And if you don't mind, go ahead and subscribe. Hope you have a good day. See you next time.